This is Ryan Pierce, host of Completely Serious. Thanks for listening to the following broadcast on Public House Media.
What's up, everybody? This is Christian Heimel, host of Press Row here on Public House Media. Thanks for listening to the following broadcast on Public House Media. Once you're done with this episode, I hope you'll come check out my show, Press Row, where we talk about the biggest issues in sports with the analysts, experts, and reporters who cover them. No nonsense, hard-hitting interviews on the sports topics you're talking about. A new show comes out every single Thursday. And don't forget to subscribe on iTunes so you never miss an episode of Press Row. Thanks again for checking out the following broadcast on Public House Media.
Hey everyone, welcome to Beauties and Headcanons, where we're nerdy and you probably are too. This is Emily, and I have our new official co-hosts with me today, Elizabeth and Lindsay, and we are here to talk nerdy to you. Today, we are going to get to know our new official co-hosts, and to do that, we are going to be playing a game, and maybe you already guessed, we're going to be playing Jeopardy! So, I'm going to be the contestant in this game, and Elizabeth and Lindsay have come up with questions and categories for me, so we're going to see how well I know them. Because I've known Lindsay for a little while, and I just met Elizabeth when we first started doing episodes together. So this will be interesting.
All right. So since we have a Beauties and Headcanons podcast, we thought it would be cool to talk to you about the different fandoms that we ascribe to. And I thought it would be great to talk about what a fandom is, because we all have our own fandoms. A fandom is a subculture composed of fans, characterized by a feeling of empathy and camaraderie with others who share this common interest. Fans typically are interested in even minor details of the objects of their fandom and spend a significant portion of their time and energy involved in their interest, often as part of a social network with particular practices. All right, so Elizabeth is going to talk about the categories that we've got for Emily to choose from.
All right, we've got four different categories, and we have four questions within those categories. Now, two of these questions are for myself and two are from Lindsay, but you're not going to know which are which. And that's going to be part, of the test, is figuring out not only the answer, but figuring out which one of us it belongs to. Some of them might be easy, but some of them might be a little bit more difficult.
Okay.
So the categories we have are first fandoms, which is what are some of the first fandoms that we got involved with? One, maybe as we're younger, or maybe as we're an adult, the first big fandoms we got involved in.
Okay.
The second category is least favorites, which is what is a fandom that we really dislike for one reason or another in particular.
All right.
I hope this won't cause too much contention.
I hope not. It'll be interesting to see why those are your opinions too. So cool.
Oh yeah. Well, we will definitely be talking about that a little bit. Third category is hopefuls, and these are fandoms that we're interested in or maybe hoping to get into, but for one reason or another, we just haven't taken the plunge yet.
Okay.
And then the fourth category is biggest fandoms, which is what are the biggest fandoms that we are currently into? As you probably know, as nerds, you know, you kind of sometimes go in between certain fandoms at different times.
Yeah.
So this is just right now at this date and time, what are the biggest fandoms that we are involved in?
Makes sense. Alrighty. Awesome.
Alrighty. Okay.
So the person who is reading the question doesn't mean that they wrote the question.
Exactly.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure. All right. So I'm going to pick, let's see. We'll start off kind of, I think, to me, this might be easy to start off with. So I'm going to start off with biggest fandoms for 200.
Biggest fandoms for 200. Mm-hmm. The answer is Mark Ruffalo voices the Hulk for the first time in Thor Ragnarok, where in previous films of this franchise, the character was voiced by Lou Ferrigno.
Oh.
You know it, and you don't even know you know it.
I'm sure. And what is Marvel? I don't know.
Ding, ding. Yeah.
Okay.
What is the Marvel Cinematic Universe?
Okay.
All right, so that's so 200 points for you.
Yay! So I guess.
Yes, you have to guess who that came from.
Hmm. Maybe. be... I feel like this is a Lindsay question, because it has to do with voicing. Yes! Yes! Okay.
People who have heard my previous podcast know this about me. This is my baby. I have things I cosplay as, and ideas in the mix for different comic cons and wizard cons to go to. So I absolutely love the Marvel Cinematic Universe. If I could just, you know, meet the Cap, that'd be great.
Oh, yeah. That would be awesome.
So that's kind of my biggest fandom right now. All right, so 300 points. Way to go.
Okay. Off to a good start here. Cool. Let's go with hopefuls for 200. I think I'd like to get a sampling of each of the categories, and then maybe I'll whittle my way down in each of them after. Okay.
Alrighty. Hopefuls for 200. In one episode of the television show, Prince Charming mentions to Snow White about falling through a portal to Asgard, a reference to Marvel's Thor.
What is Once Upon a Time?
Ding, ding, ding! We have a winner!
Yes!
Now, which one of us do you think it is?
I want to say Lindsay, but I think it's Elizabeth.
Should have gone with your first instinct. Come on, it was me. All right.
It was. Okay. But that was good. All right.
Once Upon a Time is a fandom that I'd like to get into more. Hopefuls is our category for that. I'm trying to watch it with my daughter, trying to catch up on it, but I think I've only seen season one. And I feel like the Grimm fairy tales and the fairy tales that they talk about in there are really amazing, and it's so much fun to do live action television shows with my 10-year-old daughter. So I feel like it could be a really, pardon the pun, but a rabbit hole for her and I.
Gotten into that one. I think I, so far I've seen through like season four. And Something why I made it that far, but on the other hand, it's like you gotta know what's coming next, you know? It draws you in. So, but I do have 500 total so far, which is good.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, we'll go to least favorites for 200 then.
All right. The answer is this book series, written initially as Twilight fan fiction, is constantly criticized for writing BDSM as a whole dangerously wrong.
What is 50 Shades of Grey?
Awesome.
Okay. Good. Oh. I think this was Elizabeth.
Mm-hmm.
Yep, it was me. And it was just kind of one of my least favorites just because, well, number one, as a writer, the writing, the grammar, everything in it is just, it's horrific. And knowing that they're, you know, I'm an unpublished writer who, admittedly, yes, I write fan fiction, but the stuff I write is much better than that, for one. And for two, the dangerous way that it depicts BDSM, it really... I think it makes people intrigued about it, but people can end up going about it the wrong way.
Yeah.
Just because it's not portrayed correctly. And I think that's can be kind of a dangerous thing.
Yeah. Yep.
So, awesome. Okay.
Yes.
Super. Now you've got another question to pick.
Yes. I'm going to go with First Fandoms for 200.
All right. First Fandoms for 200. This 1977 film is considered a solid classic in the geek arena throughout its countless iterations through movies, novels, comics, and even cartoons.
What is Batman?
No.
No. Okay. All right. Can you restate the question so that I hear it better this time? But you can say it again. I know I got it wrong, but I want to hear it again in case that changes what I would have said.
All right, this 1977 film is considered a solid classic in the geek arena throughout its countless iterations through movies, novels, comics, and even cartoons.
I heard 57. That's why I said Batman.
Oh.
I know it should be Star Wars.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I heard 57 for some reason. I'm so sorry.
Yes, you should be sorry.
I am terribly sorry. Wow. Oh my goodness. I would have gotten that for sure if I heard 77. Okay. Let's see. But I think
are you going to guess whose that was? Okay.
I am going to guess. Yeah. I'm thinking that's Elizabeth as well.
It is, and I'm pretty sure we had talked about that at some point.
We may have.
Star Wars was one of the first I got into. I grew up in a really, really strict home where not a lot was allowed geek-wise, but Star Wars, for whatever reason, was one of them. And so I ended up just latching onto it early on.
Yeah, but Star Wars is a good one to get started in.
Oh yeah, definitely a solid pick for a first fandom.
So, do I get my bonus 100 for knowing the correct person, or do I get anything for getting the whole thing wrong because I didn't hear it?
You get the bonus points.
Yay!
All right, ready to get into the meat of the question?
I think so. I think we are. Let's do first fandoms for 400.
All right, so the answer to this question is, the author was rejected 12 times before she was finally able to publish this series.
What is Harry Potter?
Well done.
Yes. Yes. who did this one? Lindsay.
Nope.
Okay.
Ruskin.
All right.
That was me.
I was very torn.
Well, this was actually something I got into as an adult. I didn't grow up with it like a lot of people did. Mm-hmm. And that was because, you know, again, I grew up in a very, very strict household and I wasn't allowed to read the books. Okay. But once I grew up and I moved out, I actually was just interested in it. So I picked up the books and I borrowed them from a friend and read them and watched the movies and just fell in love with it.
Nice. Yeah. I mean, my husband wasn't allowed to read them growing up either. I understand that. And he really wanted to. All right, we'll do first fandoms for 6.
All right. The answer is, according to some anime experts and industry statistics, this cartoon brought awareness to a larger mainstream audience to anime, which fueled the North American anime and manga industries.
Oh, boy. Can you say it one more time, please?
Sure. According to some anime experts and industry statistics, this cartoon brought awareness to a larger mainstream audience to anime, which fueled the North American anime and manga industries.
I have a couple options floating around, but I'm going to go with, what is Pokemon?
Oh, no.
Oh. Okay. What was
it? So close. The answer is Sailor Moon.
Oh, Sailor Moon. Okay, that was even before Pokemon, I think, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, slightly before.
Yep, okay. Okay. I think that one was Lindsay, though.
Yep.
Yep. Okay. Yay!
Oh, I should talk about why that was. Yeah. Oh. Geez, I started getting into Sailor Moon when I was in 7th grade.
Oh, yeah?
7th grade. The trivia question actually also says that it broadened the prospects for young females as well, because it was the first magic girl anime that there was. And I mean, I printed pictures. I had them all over my walls. I bought all the figurines. I did not live as a protected life as you guys did. So I was able to, I mean, we were playing with these dolls and having a great time with them. We watched the dubbing of these. And then we also watched the Japanese ones so that we're trying to read the really bad translations. I bought the VHS tapes in Japanese. Mm. It was real.
Dedication right there.
It was definitely real. And that was definitely my first thing. My best friend, she was totally in it with me. We were a couple. We even did our hair like Sailor Moon for a while there. Yeah. It was good stuff.
That is awesome. That is awesome. I will say, I wouldn't count this as one of my first fandoms, but it, when I was probably in like kindergarten or first or second grade, I got up early in the morning
before anyone else was. Yes, Telemundo!
And I would totally turn on the TV and Sailor Moon was on at like 6 o'clock a.m. And yes. I would just hang out and watch Sailor Moon. I had no idea what was going on, but then I would go out and play in the playground and pretend I was spinning around on the swing set like Sailor Moon.
I love it.
That's great. Yeah, like, I wouldn't call it my first fandom because I had no idea, like, any of the storyline or the backstory or anything. But, you know, It's just, like, I remember pretending I was Sailor Moon, even though I had no idea what it was.
I'll be honest, I knew their names in Japanese and in English and in dub and everything. Oh, wow. It was great.
Yeah.
Awesome. All right, what's your next one?
Ooh. I'm going to go with hopefuls for 400.
Hopefuls for 400.
All right, the answer to this question is, this show used many metaphors to point out the dual or hidden nature of its characters, notably between Vanessa and Mina.
Ooh. Vanessa and Mina. I feel like I should know this because I don't have an answer. I time out. Beep, beep.
All right. the answer is, what is Penny Dreadful?
Oh, yep. No, not a clue.
Yeah. I'm always talking about how I don't really like vampire stuff very much. And this one's got a lot of weird folklore stuff in it. It's a hopeful of mine because I... oh my gosh, I didn't even let you guess that one.
That's okay.
it negates because you didn't even know it.
Yeah, I wouldn't have known either.
I really like some of the actors in it, and I like the way it's being filmed. Okay. But it's been hard for me. This one's a hopeful of mine that I'd like to get more into it, and I'd like to start paying better attention. I guess that there's never enough time to watch and do everything you want. So
I know.
That's one of mine. I'm hoping to get more into it.
Okay.
We'll see.
It's Penny Dreadful.
Penny Dreadful. It's on Netflix. There's a couple of seasons, I think.
Okay.
I don't
Is
know.
Is it live action or anime or
It's live action. Yep.
Okay. All right.
It's got the actress who played Rose in Doctor Who in it.
Oh, Billie Piper.
Yeah, Billie Piper's okay. in it. And she gotcha. She's got a Cockney accent. It's so
Yay.
Great.
Fun.
Oh,
that would be great.
Makes me so
yes.
excited. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's so fun to like hear those British actors speaking slightly differently,
yes.
you know? Because, like,
yes.
I don't know if you guys know that, you guys probably do, that David Tennant is actually Scottish, so he actually has
oh,
a
yes.
Scottish accent.
Oh, yeah.
So, like, there was that one episode where they landed in the Scottish countryside or something, so he had to use his normal speaking voice instead of his English accent, and it was great. Like, I loved that one.
I've seen him in a couple other things, too, like Jessica Jones and Broadchurch.
Okay.
And it is so weird to see him just talking normal, like talking with the Scottish accent. And the accentuation
realize.
Of the accent is so cool. Yeah.
You realize, like, that's how he normally talks? Like,
yes.
Right. So, okay. Awesome. Let's keep going through hopefuls then. I'll do 600.
All right. This series has had multiple iterations through novels, films, and TV series. This BBC rendition is already considered a classic.
Okay, it's BBC. Can you say one more time, please?
Sure. This series has had multiple iterations through novels, films, and TV series. This BBC rendition is already considered a classic.
What is Sherlock?
Yes!
I got it! Oh, yeah! All right. I'm gonna say that this one was Lindsay.
No, that one was me.
Okay. All right.
And I know some of my friends will probably be disappointed because, you know, it's kind of one of those things where it's like logical. Yeah, you should like that because that's just something that you should like. It's
yeah,
you. It's totally you. But it's just one of those things that I've never gotten a chance to like really sit down and mm-hmm. watch it. I've watched a little bit of it, but I haven't watched it like from the beginning.
Gotcha.
Like I've seen one episode, but
mm-hmm. one of the longer episodes too.
Yeah,
so
but I just haven't gotten the chance to yet. So
yeah, I've enjoyed all of it that I've seen so far. I think I've seen at least through season 3, if not most of the way through season 4. And there's only a few episodes per season, so at
yeah.
your pace, hop right in.
Yeah,
I mean,
exactly.
I think there is a like super fandom, like a fandom combined of fandoms called Super Wholuckians.
Yes, and I am a part of two of those fandoms, so
exactly.
I'm closing in on the third.
Exactly. We've got Supernatural, Doctor Who, and Sherlock all combined in there.
Yes.
So, yeah, You just finish it, round it out.
I just got to do it.
Exactly. All right. So
wait a minute. So
go ahead, Lindsay. Yeah.
Super Hulakians?
Yes, you've never heard that mm-hmm. before. That's okay.
No.
I found out about it from Facebook groups that I'm part of. And like there is one called Super Hulakians. And,
oh my goodness.
There was just way too much supernatural stuff in there, and I'm like, I have no clue about these. Right. So I ended up leaving the group because there was just so much supernatural stuff that I didn't know anything about. But I was in there because I love Sherlock and I love Doctor Who. So I call it a super fandom because it's not a sub fandom inside right. of a fandom. It's combining other ones together. So
I feel sort of left out. I'm only in one of those fandoms.
Oh my. Well, you're getting into supernatural. Yeah. So mm-hmm. I don't know. Who knows? Maybe you'll round it out too.
We'll see. Sherlock doesn't sound too bad if I'm honest. So
yeah, exactly. Exactly. All right, we'll finish up hopefuls then with hopefuls for 800.
Okay, hopefuls for 800. It's going to be, the answer is, this anime draws from real-life figure ice skaters to write its drama.
Oh.
This is why it's 800 points.
Yeah, I can tell. My goodness. Oh. I don't know if I've heard of this. I'm going to have to time out on this one, too. I don't know.
The answer is, what is Yuri on Ice?
Nope. I've never heard of that one.
Can you guess who it might have been?
I'm going to guess it was Lindsay.
Nope.
No,
it was me.
Okay.
Elizabeth stumped you on that one.
Yeah, man, you got me.
I'm kind of picky with my anime, but this one has come pretty highly recommended from some of my friends. I also, once we actually got TV, I started watching, that was one of the things I could watch was figure skating. So, you know, I would watch figure skaters like Oksana Bayul and Tanya Harding and Michelle Kwan and Christy Yamaguchi. And so I really, really got into it. So I think, you know, if that kind of continues on that theme, I think that would be something I would really enjoy because it's kind of a callback to something else I really liked when I was little.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah. No, I don't remember. Did I do first fandoms for 800? I don't have anything written down next to that.
No, you did not.
I skipped it. I went out of order. That's okay. All right, so I finished off hopefuls. I'm going to go back to first fandoms and finish that one off for 800.
All right. The answer is, the critical acclaim for this television series was so high that the UN held a special symposium to discuss the themes of race, gender, religion, and terrorism, and how they related to the modern era.
Wow.
Yeah, we're really getting with those 800s.
Yeah, a TV series, you say?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Are you allowed to tell me what country it's from? Like, what country the producer is from or whatever?
It is American.
I'm going to go with Star Trek. What is Star Trek?
No, you are kind of in the right field there. Oh, okay. With the sci-fi. It is what is Battlestar Galactica.
Ah, okay. That's one I have not delved into. Okay, what is Battlestar Galactica? And I'm going to say Lindsay for that one.
And that is correct.
Yeah!
All right, so this one is near and dear to my heart. It was right after high school, maybe actually a couple of years afterwards, and it had been done on television. So mm-hmm. Caprica was already out. Battlestar Galactica was in DVDs. And I had a really good friend of mine who got me watching it, and I just fell in love. Everything about it, the Cylons, the different storylines with Starbuck, and oh my goodness, Starbuck.
I have heard of Starbuck.
Everyone in it, to be completely honest, it's been a while since I got to sit down and watch it. But even my daughter was really interested for a while, and this was at least 5 years ago. So she was watching, Cylons and intergalactic battles and all kinds of other cool stuff. I also found out that Edward James Olmos, who plays Captain Adama, he actually wanted to keep all of the alien stuff out of the show to really? Keep it as a human drama. Yeah.
Interesting.
So even though it is sci-fi, it's based more on the human drama. Mm-hmm. And there's a really awesome saying in the show, too, where he says, "So say we all." And that is completely improvised, and it stayed with the show.
Oh, that's cool.
It's like a it's kind of like a prayer. I don't know if yeah, either of you guys have
like
ever seen it, but
salutation
it's
salutation.
Yes,
thing.
It's kind of like saying amen or something cool. like that. So it's just my favorite show ever.
That's awesome.
I need to sit down and watch more of it, but then no one will see me for a few months.
Yeah.
So I probably shouldn't, but I'd love to.
Yeah. I gotcha. No, I've been interested in it. I just never actually took the time to watch it. And I know there's a couple different series of it out. There's the original, and I think there was like a modernization of it or something. Is that right?
Yes. Okay. Yep. So the modernization is what I fell in love with. The just like with Doctor Who, Battlestar Galactica did have an original television series as well. It had a little different feel to it, different storyline. And then after Battlestar Galactica, they also advanced the Cylon story where I don't know very much about it, but it's called Caprica. And that is a planet where the Cylons and humans something happens. I unfortunately my memory is not that great and I really never watched it. So
gotcha.
That's something I need to
gotta get in.
I
there
need to block off a couple months to get into. Yep.
Gotcha. Okay. Well, let's keep moving on then. We're getting close to our time frame here. So let's get into least favorites. I'll do least favorites for four.
Least favorites for 400. The answer is this book series, which started in 2007, was a big hit. Some say for all the wrong reasons, criticizing its romanticizing of abusive relationships.
Well, in this category, we already had 50 Shades of Grey, so I'm assuming that this is going to be a different series. Mm-hmm. I'm going to go with What is Twilight?
Ding, ding, ding.
Yeah!
All right, so whose was that?
Yeah, ooh. Lindsay.
Nope.
Nope. Ah, nope. Shoot. Okay.
It was mine again.
Man, you and your dislike of romance series.
Well, and see, that's the thing. It's not that I dislike romance. I write, actually, the majority of what I personally write is romance.
Oh, yeah?
I very rarely write general fiction.
Gotcha.
The thing is I don't like it when it's very badly written.
Yep.
Where it romanticizes abusive relationships,
right.
Where the female character is just this blank slate and she is just totally dependent on this male character.
Yep.
Without him, she is just nothing. And it's just not healthy.
All right, so then I'm going to keep going on least favorites, and we'll do least favorites for 600 then.
All right. As of 2016, this show became the longest-running vampire show, beating Buffy the Vampire Slayer and True Blood.
Oh. See, those are the two vampire shows that I'm familiar with. So... Yeah, I'm going to have to call it on this one. I don't have any guesses on it.
And the answer is, what is The Vampire Diaries?
Oh, okay. I have heard of that one. I just didn't pay much attention to it because it reminded me of, like, what is that show? Pretty Little Liars, but with vampires. That's what it makes me think of. So I just kind of, nope. I'm not into Pretty Little Liars, so I don't know. But I do think, though, I think this one was, yeah, because the first two in this category were Elizabeth, so this one has to be a Lindsay question. So I think I
right?
got that, right?
Yes.
Yay!
So this one is one of my least favorites because, geez, Emily, I've never seen Pretty Little Liars, but I assume I wouldn't like that one either.
I don't know. It's just whenever I
don't know.
Like
I just never
that.
Liked.
Yeah.
the two main vampire characters and fighting over this female, or I don't know, and she didn't really have much of a strong character until she finds out that she's, like, got this ancestry of powerful vampire lineage nonsense, and
okay.
I just, and everybody was always in love with Nina Dobrev, and I just, my little sister loved it. She bought the DVD, and I just couldn't get into it.
Yeah.
So this one's just one that I, you know, we also talked about the poor writing or the female characters, and I think it's safe to say all three of us like strong female characters.
When
they have to depend on male influence and stuff, we just don't handle that well, I guess.
Yeah.
That one's definitely true for this one for me. I
gotcha.
Never liked it because even the witch female character, she didn't seem too strong to me until she knew she had some kind of lineage. Like, she was never strong on her own, and that
gotcha.
Always really irritates me.
At any rate, okay. All right, so that was the, yeah, we finished up least favorite for six. I guess that it was Lindsay who got that right. Yeah?
Yes.
Is that where we left
off? So now you need the least favorite for eight.
Yes, okay, so I'll move on with least favorite, and then we'll finish that off that category for 800.
Okay, so least favorites for 800. That one is a bonus daily double question.
Oh, boy. Oh, so this one I get to, like, bet my points on, huh?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. So go ahead with it, I think, and then we'll see.
All right. So the answer is this long-running series was heavily inspired by Neil Gaiman, the dark fantasy writer of Sandman, Coraline, and American Gods.
Helped very much. I mean, it is 800. But I could, if I don't
Double.
Know, I could guess, or I could bet a low amount and then not very much.
Right. And this one is one of our least favorites. Well, my least favorite.
I know this one's a Lindsay question, so I get that. But, okay, so it's one of Lindsay's least favorite.
Do you need a hint?
Maybe a small one.
Okay. You've mentioned this one a couple times in the show already, talking about things that Elizabeth and I both like, and this might be a surprise to you. Because it's something we've talked about a lot.
Okay, well then, obviously, I think, all right, I'm going to bet 800 just in case it's not. I'm going to bet my 800 on it. So I could get 1600 on this, but I'm going to go half.
You could.
So I'll do 800 just to be sure, because I don't know. I mean, you might be throwing me for a loop here, but I'm going to say that, what is Supernatural?
Yep.
Okay.
No.
All right.
This
so,
one is.
So that is a surprise, though, because Lindsay, I thought you've been enjoying it so far.
Elizabeth and I talked about this one.
Yeah.
And I wasn't sure if I should put it on here because we have talked about it a lot lately, and the reason it is on my one of my least favorites is because even though there are things that I really liked about it, the lore and the Christian Dead Sea Scrolls that it pulls from, I really had problems with some of the writing and the dialogue.
Oh, okay. So I you didn't necessarily talk about those aspects.
Right.
I mean, we've talked about it before. So that makes sense, though.
So the watchability for me was very difficult.
Yeah. Yeah, but, like, the stories and the background that it plays off of is what kind of draws you in.
It's the redeeming factor for me.
Yes. Okay, the redeeming factor. Well, I'll give you that. Yeah, that makes sense. Okay.
And here's where the other shoe drops. To a certain extent, I do agree with Lindsay.
Oh.
There are actually couple of writers on the show specifically that whenever they come in, it's like they just totally mess things up. It's like the teenage boys that come in and just leave the clothes everywhere and the food out of the pantry and just, you know, they just mess up everything. They, you know, toss good characters out the window. They don't develop the characters well. They take on these controversial topics that, you know, they could be handled well, that, you know, topics that, you know, could probably be talked about, but they don't handle it well. And so that always upsets me when I see that they're going to be writing an episode, because I'm like, no, I don't even want to watch the episode now.
Why would you even? Gotcha. Yeah. And sometimes I feel that way. Like, there's, I have my favorite Doctor Who writers and things too. And sometimes I'm like, oh, I know this episode's going to be good. And then sometimes I'm like, I don't know who that writer is. We'll see. And, you know, some of the weird episodes come out, you know. So we'll do last category then and cruise right on through that one. Biggest fandoms for 400.
All right. This 2005 series is still on air, currently in its 13th season.
What is Doctor Who?
Incorrect.
Oh!
This one is Supernatural.
Oh! Okay. All right. You want to know why I said Doctor Who? Because I totally... That makes so much more sense now that you say it's Supernatural. But I said Doctor Who because the revival started in 2005. And it's in its, I don't know, whatever its season now. The 13th Doctor. That's why.
Yeah. Okay. It's serious. That's so why I wanted to put it in here twice. Yeah, I knew it would throw you at one point.
Yep. No, you totally got me on that one. Okay. But that, I know, I think this one's an Elizabeth question.
It is. It is.
Okay.
And despite the issues with the writing, at least as a writer myself, I see the potential and what it could be. Whereas, you know, with something like Twilight, there's really nothing of real substance there to really pull out and develop. Whereas with Supernatural, the potential is just there. It's like it's just below the surface. Uh-huh. And as a writer, I enjoy, you know, kind of chipping away at that and pulling it out and playing around with it. It's it's fandom that I've actually posted the most stories in for Archive of Our Own. So, you know, it definitely does speak to me on that level. It's something that I just really can get into and write.
Awesome. No, that's cool, because it's like inspiring to you and you can do something you really enjoy with it. Yeah, that's very awesome. Okay, so we've got last two questions here. I'm going to go for biggest fandom 600 and then we'll wrap it up with 800 after that. Let's go.
All right.
Let's do this.
The answer is... this video game series, which started with Arena in 1994, released its most recent game in 2014.
Oh. Video game series. The first one was Arena in 94, you said.
Yes.
Most recent one was in 2014?
Mm-hmm.
Can you say which console it's with? Or if it's on computer?
No.
You can't. Okay. And maybe it's across multiple platforms too, so I don't know. But I'm gonna guess Super Smash Brothers. What is Super Smash Brothers?
No.
Okay. I don't know.
It is, what is Elder Scrolls?
Oh. I didn't know that the first one was called Arena. I did not know that. Elder Scrolls, huh? Okay. See, because I'm familiar with the Elder Scrolls games, but I always thought that the first game was Morrowind.
Yep, and see, that's where I knew I would trip you up, because a lot of people think of Morrowind, but that's... actually only when Bethesda took over and started releasing the game. The first actual game that started with Bethesda. Elder Scrolls was Arena. It was released back in 1994 for MS-DOS. I know I'm taking you back there a little bit.
Yeah, DOS.
And then the most recent game was Elder Scrolls Online, which I knew that might throw you too, because you probably thought it was Skyrim. But
no,
Elder Scrolls Online...
I knew about Elder Scrolls Online. My husband was super jazzed about that, but I don't think he plays at the moment. But, yeah. No, I did know
but
about
yeah,
that
it is
one.
Considered, it is considered a part of canon, even though it is an MMORPG instead of just a single-player RPG. But Bethesda, even though they didn't fully develop it themselves, they outsourced it to ZeniMax, but they still consider it a part of the Elder Scrolls canon. So it is an official Elder Scrolls game.
Gotcha. That is interesting to know, because that's another thing my husband was not 100% on board about, was that it's, you know, an MMO instead of a single player. And so it's like, well, is this going to be like World of Warcraft? Are we going to have like all these, you know, weird side things and stuff? And it's still, I feel like it would still be Elder Scrolls enough, because Skyrim, or not Skyrim, like the Elder Scrolls world is huge. So...
It is huge, and it kind of goes a little bit back in time with the lore, so that is kind of something that makes it a little bit different. I actually started playing with Skyrim, and then I went back and played Oblivion, and then I kind of jumped forward and played Elder Scrolls Online. I unfortunately don't have a console or a computer to play Morrowind or any of the other games with, but but I am very passionate about that. That's another fandom that I actually do write in, so...
Nice. All right, so I didn't actually get the chance to guess, but since it was a video game question, I was already going to guess that this was Elizabeth's question. So, all right, so then our last question for the game here. We've got biggest fandoms for 800, and I already know that this is a Lizzie question because that's the only one left. So, all right, let me have it.
Okay, for the first season of this television show in 2005, producers were fearful of alienating new audiences with references to the original show, so such things as names and events were kept to a bare minimum until audiences adjusted to the mythology.
I think this one, I'm going to say, what is Doctor Who?
That is correct.
Wow.
I was debating because I'm like, well, Star Trek could have done that too. But Star Trek is usually pretty straightforward.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, Doctor Who.
Oh, yes. So Doctor Who is one of my other biggest fandom. Again, with the wanting to cosplay as characters. Mm-hmm. Dr. Donna.
Dr. Donna.
Dr. Donna. I could so rock the red hair and be Dr. Donna.
Oh, yeah.
Not to mention the actress who plays her is just pretty awesome as it is. So yeah, Doctor Who, I had to give you questions that like weren't super straightforward. So I'm really impressed you got this one. And they said that they just didn't want to steer people away from it by bringing too much of the original show in.
Yeah.
Into the storyline.
And that's part of, I think that's what helped me get into it.
Right.
Is what they did with that, because mm-hmm. I wouldn't have understood if they started talking about, like, all these, the Gallifrey and the, mm-hmm. And the Time War and yada yada and everything that, you know, other viewers that started from the very beginning would have already known about. I would have been lost.
And of course it helped to have Chris Eccleston and Billy on the forefront there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he did a fantastic job.
No, definitely my favorite doctor out of all of them so far.
Yeah.
What I think is interesting about this one, too, is recently, Emily, you guys talked about Serenity and Firefly.
Yes.
And how that was mismarketed.
Yes.
And I thought it was very interesting that this being in a different country, they marketed it completely different. And it worked. Everybody who saw that season wanted to continue to watch it. And Firefly was misrepresented here in the States. So, we probably should have gotten some marketing advice from the guys that...
Yeah. The guys over at BBC did.
Exactly.
Well, and I think, and I talked about this in my episode about Firefly, I think Fox wanted something from Joss Whedon that Joss Whedon wasn't going to give them.
Right.
He wanted and this is a Joss- different kind of yeah. show. And Fox wanted something like Buffy and Angel again.
Right.
And,
right.
And that he wanted something different. And so.
And you know what's Fox funny was, is I think I even remember the television commercials, or maybe I saw something, because I remember seeing that commercial and being like, what show are they talking about? Because it couldn't possibly be Firefly. I've already seen that, and it's not anything like what they're talking about. I remember not even knowing what harlot they were talking about and all that other nonsense. So I was really flabbergasted by that.
I didn't even hear about the show until 10 years after it was released.
Right.
Until it quit. And then I found out how they were trying to promote it. And I'm like,
Wait, what
in the world is this? It is weird. Like, it didn't even follow it completely misrepresented. So,
all right. So how many points do you have, my dear?
Let me see. I have to add up my categories here. $4,400 points. Woohoo!
Well, and Elizabeth, what does she get for all those points?
Did I do that right? Hold on. Do I have? No, it's 54. Math is fun. I was a math teacher for 2 years. Did you just know that?
You know what you get for that?
What do I get?
You get the satisfaction of knowing your co-host.
Yay! Oh, that's so wonderful. Oh. So this was like, whose line is it anyway, where everything's made up of the points don't matter.
Yes.
Exactly.
Oh, that's awesome. All right. Well, I'd had a ton of fun, though, with both of you, and I do feel like I know you both a little bit better now. So that is lovely. And I'm sure the listeners know all of us a little better now as well, because we got to talk about all this fun stuff. So, very cool.
Yeah. I think we made fun of each other enough, too.
I think we did, but, you know, maybe we can do that a little more in the future. I mean, you know, this won't be our all last right. episode together, so.
Certainly hope so.
All right. Well, thanks, you guys, for getting nerdy with us today. Thank you, listeners, for getting nerdy with us, and hopefully you will continue to get nerdy with us in the future. You can also talk nerdy to us if you want to. We'd love to hear what is a fandom that you want to hear about from us. Maybe it can be one of the ones we've already talked about in this episode, or one that you have been hoping to hear from us about and haven't yet. We'd love to find out. Just find us on Facebook, Twitter, or Tumblr and share those topic suggestions. Also, go ahead and subscribe to this podcast and others from Public House Media on iTunes, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, and wherever other good podcasts are found. We love feedback, too, so if you liked this episode, or even if you didn't, please give us a rating and a review so that we can keep making great episodes for you. I'm Emily.
I'm Lindsay.
And I'm Elizabeth, and thanks for getting nerdy with us on Beauties and Headcanons.